Happy Tuesday. Happy June. It's time for coffee and Cursey words. I'm so glad to be here. I've missed you guys. My camera is moving again. She keeps shifting. How are you? It's good to see you. And if you are on the replay crew, we love you. There will be timestamps down below at the end of the live, and you can hop to the topics that you're most interested in. Today, I'm going to touch on everything that I have been tagged in the few days I have not been on the interwebs. I take a no social Sunday. And this week it was Memorial Day. So I took Sunday and Monday. So my Twitter was very busy when I peeked in this morning, but also my parents were in town last week. My son broke his shoulder slipping while he was running. So it's been very, very busy. But we're going to jump into it. Today, I'm going to talk a little bit about the revelation that Kim Kardashian failed the baby bar, because I've got asked a lot about what that is. So real quick on that, the speculation regarding a Tati Westbrook KJ without a crystal ball settlement. I've got a lot of thoughts about that. Then we're going to jump into two lawsuits. We're going to speed run them today as fast as we can. There is a lawsuit against multiple YouTube channels, Adam Yates and Sherelle's World. A bunch of you guys tagged me in it. That complaint is just a sneak peek. It's a mess. And then Amanda Ensing did in fact sue Sephora. It is available. We're going to go over that one too. We've got so much to cover today. So it is June. The Pride stuff is live. I am so happy. It feels like summer. So happy Pride, everybody. I'm very, very happy that it's summer. It's great that it's June. And I saw all the chats in the comments. Little guy is doing good. He's going to be in a sling. It's, you know, he's hurt himself just enough to, you know, cancel all of the summer camps and things like that, but not enough that it is wild or he needs surgery or anything like that. He's got a buckle fracture, not uncommon in the kiddos. And I have two boys, so not uncommon in my world either. Not uncommon that there are casts. This just being a sling is actually kind of nice, but his shoulder definitely hurts. I'm no stranger to shoulder problems, so I empathize. But he's managing to get really good at his iPad with just the one hand, so I think he'll be just fine. Let's get into it, y'all. There's so much to talk about. So hey there. If we haven't met yet, I'm Emily D. Baker, the badass lawyer and everyone's favorite legal commentator. I'm the host of The Emily Show, and I break down the legal shit behind the news and pop culture stories we all want to talk about. I have been a licensed attorney for over 15 years, but this is not legal advice. I should warn you, I'm a big fan of the Cursey words. This channel is where the law nerds unite to talk about facts, not fuckery. Just a quick reminder as we get into it for any of you that are catching a live for the first time, please go ahead and put a one in the chat that this is your first time catching a live. We're just going to do a quick catch up, because whenever we talk about creators who are polarizing, and we're talking about a few polarizing creators today, there is always some confusion when I put down the hammer on the name calling. Our chat is not a place for name calling. I don't like name calling. And I generally am like, say whatever you want, but there's consequences. I will tone police the shit out of my chat. We don't name call even creators that we think suck. There is none of it, because it is a safe place to have conversation about facts. And name calling is not facts. It's feelings. And y'all are welcome to have your feelings. But name calling in the chat does not help. And I know all of you know that, but occasionally when we talk about polarizing creators, those who have not been in the chat before come in and are like, why can't I call this person a bitch? No, that's not what we're doing. We're not name calling women. If you don't like their behavior, you can say this behavior is a problem for me. So That's what we're going with. That's what we always go with. The mods sometimes have to bear the flack from everyone being like, well, why are you timing me out? That's why we keep the chat a place to have conversation, not Thunderdome. I don't like it in other chats, and I don't tell any other creator how to run their chat. But in my chat, we have conversations, not Thunderdome style name calling. Little Keddy Cat sent a wonderful super chat, said, I was born to be bi. I'm a June baby. Also hope your baby feels better soon. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. And I love seeing all of the rainbow flags in the chat. It's just so great. So for all of you who are new, we've got over 2,000 people in the chat right now. For all of you who are new, we will do the topics real quick. We will swoop into them, and then I will do questions and get to super chats at the end, because otherwise your girl who is totally ADHD will get distracted, and we will go off into other directions. And that is not helpful, because I will never get through how much we have to talk about today. Krista said, you convinced me to start watching Real Housewives. I'm sorry, but there's so many. I don't know where to start. Which should I watch first? It depends which tea you're interested in. You know, all of the franchises are good. They're all different. Some of them longer than others. You could probably pick up a franchise by going back one season and kind of getting caught up. Salt Lake City has the shortest if you're interested in the Jen Shah drama. Beverly Hills is going on right now. If you're curious about all of the stuff coming out with Erica Girardi, you could probably go back last season and catch up with this season and be fine with Beverly Hills. You don't need like the full back seasons. So it depends on which drama you want to catch up with. I would figure out which drama you're interested in and then get into that season. I will be talking about Housewives probably more on our members only live stream this Thursday. For all of you who are members, there is a members only live stream the first Thursday of every month. And since today is June, it will be the first Thursday of this month, which is this Thursday at 7 p.m. I will be shifting the times going forward so that we can accommodate for international time zones, but I've not announced that yet. And I'm not even officially announcing it now, so I don't want to throw everybody off. We have been talking for like 7 minutes. We should just get into the quick things right now. So let's get into that. Let's get into that. Let's swoop. We're going to talk about Kim Kardashian real quick. Just real quick. Yes, Beyond Authentic, it is... Members only live stream is to all members. Kelly Pan here. Hello. I came out of the cabinet. You're hilarious. I love that. Not the closet. And I'm so excited to celebrate Pride this month and every month. Love the supportive channel. You are welcome. And we love you too. So I am happy that you guys are here. All right. Let's real quickly talk about Kim Kardashian as it relates to the bar. We're going to get into her getting sued a different day, because there's so many lawsuits, y'all. Today, we're just wading into the YouTube pond of lawsuits. We're not getting into the whole wide world of lawsuits. Today is like YouTube related lawsuits only. It's wild. But okay, first, I've gotten asked a lot about Kim Kardashian becoming a lawyer. She announced in April 2019, I think on her show, and like Kanye had it in an article with Vanity Fair or something. Don't quote me. I don't remember the publication exactly. Could have been Vogue. It's something with a V, I think. Either way, he announced she was becoming a lawyer. She talked about her becoming a lawyer. She, to my knowledge, did not graduate from an undergraduate program and apply to law school, which is kind of your traditional path. You go to a four-year university, you apply to law school, you go to an ABA accredited law school, you take the bar, you pass the bar. I mean, in California, that is a big question mark. You pass the bar at some point, and then you become an attorney. And then how good of an attorney you are, well, it just depends on a lot of factors. But there are plenty of attorneys to go around in California and elsewhere, for sure. But that's not the route she's taking. She is taking an apprenticeship route. This is like way OG. This is like Abraham Lincoln style law. You know, this is when you're watching Hamilton and they become lawyers. They didn't like go to undergrad, apply to law school. They apprenticed under other lawyers. California still has this ability to apprentice law school. And if you apprentice law school, you have to do some extra hurdles that you don't have to do if you're going to an ABA accredited school. This also happens if you are going to a non-ABA accredited law school, which is something that can happen in California and makes, you know, law parity difficult from California to other states. We have a difficult bar exam and the pass rate is very low, but also we have non-accredited law schools and are the things connected? I don't know. I am not an expert in higher education. I think the cost of all of it is silly, but you can study 4 years for 864 hours of participation as a registered, unaccredited distance learning or correspondence law school, or 4 years of study under the supervision of a state judge or attorney. And that seems to be what Kim Kardashian is doing. However, when you do it that way, you have to take the first year law student's exam. The first year law student's exam is also called the baby bar. So law students that complete their first year of a, you know, JD program are waived from it. But anyone taking those more non-traditional, non-accredited routes have to take and pass that exam. So anyone who wants to become a lawyer and sit for the bar exam has to pass the first year law exam, or they don't receive credit for any law study until they pass the exam. They must pass it within the first three consecutive administrations after they are eligible to take the exam. So when you finish that first year of law school, you have three administrations of the test to pass it. And if you don't, I think you have to go back, do not collect $200, go back to the beginning. So we will see. We've already seen on the show that she has not passed it the first time. It looks like she may be taking it the second time while she and her children have COVID. That would be incredibly difficult. I don't know how one would do that, but then there would be one more opportunity to take it after that. And then if she does not pass it, who knows if she will continue on to become an attorney or not. We will see. She does quite a lot of work with justice projects. She does quite a lot of work with the wrongly convicted population and advocating for prison reform and prison rights. I think she can do a lot of that work, not as a lawyer. I think as an advocate, there's a lot of space for her to continue to do that work if she wants to. If y'all think she sucks, I totally get it. So we will see what happens with this. I understand wanting a deeper education, seeing that she's working with quite a lot of attorneys, advocating for reforms, talking to legislatures. It's not an easy thing to do. So, you know, there's credit where credit is due to be willing to study law to better understand and not just put your name on something that she seems to be passionate about. So we will see what happens if Kim Kardashian passes the baby bar and becomes a lawyer, or if she says nuts and just you know, socks the whole thing all together. We'll see. I know that the number one thing you guys want to talk about is the Tati Westbrook KJ settlement. Let me know in the chat. Do you want to get into it? Should we 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 get into it? I think we should. I think we should. I think we should. Also, it's coffee and Cursey words. So there's definitely coffee this morning. Oh, chat, I just saw all of you saying, hell yes, 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 please, yes, oh, yes, God, yes, let's do the things. All right. I have thoughts. I have a lot of thoughts. I have thoughts. It seems like we are at the end, blessedly at the end of the Tati Westbrook without a crystal ball lawsuit situation. And I say this based on things that have been shared on Twitter. You know, Twitter, the harbinger for accurate information. Twitter, where all things seem to be true. But when we look at Attorney Salty's Twitter, there was a photo of a courthouse that appears to be in Minnesota. And was location tagged, I think, on Instagram, and says Minneapolis has a beautiful courthouse due to the party's ongoing mediation efforts over the last few days. We will not be seeing the inside of it. This indicates to me that they are in mediation. Now, as you all know, I am blocked by KJ, hashtag blocked by KJ, totally fine. I have seen others reporting on things that she has tweeted, statements she has made. She's made statements that she had been in meetings for two full days. I imagine that by meetings, she meant mediation. I saw Michelle Whiskey Tango Foxtrot posted that KJ posted on May 27th. This is the number of lawsuits I have, FYI, zero. So we have seen lots of information. I've also seen screenshots that KJ was like subtweeting salts in a friendly way, which indicates to me that they sat down face to face. Now, what we know road so far, if you want to see all the backstory of the lawsuit, there's plenty of videos. But what we know about this mediation effort is we did see Salt indicate that and KJ indicate, I believe on Twitter as well, that the parties had signed or were entering into a release of the statute of limitations so that there would be more time. What that means is the statute of limitations to refile was coming up in May. They wanted more time to mediate, it seemed. And so they had waived the statute of limitations so that if Tati Westbrook and her side needed to refile counts or charges or allegations in Minneapolis, in Minnesota, where KJ and her business are, that they could do that at a later time. The only reason to bother doing that is if you reasonably believe that there might be a benefit to an ongoing settlement or mediation discussion. Now, why would you spend the money to go into mediation with somebody? Because you have to have a third-party mediator. You know, we've seen on social media, it was Saltz and Queen Levine, and I think the crew from the Seattle firm as well. That's four lawyers all flew to Minneapolis to have these conversations or to have these mediations. Why? Well, I have speculation. I have speculation based on everything I've seen go down with this case. I said at the beginning of this case that this probably had a lot to do with Clark Swanson. I still believe this has a lot to do with Clark Swanson. Who's Clark Swanson? Clark Swanson is Tati Westbrook's business partner that is suing her over the business, saying, hey, I'm entitled to half of all the things. And it seems that they are saying, no, you're not entitled to half the things. So what we also saw, as I'm jumbling the story, stick with me, is we saw KJ deleting things off of her vlog channel. We saw Saltz deleting things off of Twitter, and we saw KJ deleting things off of Twitter, like all the things. I don't know if Saltz also deleted things off of Insta or if KJ deleted things off of Insta, but why would the parties do this? Probably because they have reached some kind of an agreement that has not finished being formalized yet. And part of it was to remove all statements about the other side. And one of the easiest ways, if you are a prolific tweeter, to remove all statements regarding the other side is to just wipe it. Just wipe that shit. Just get rid of all of it. And that makes sense to me that that would happen. Also for Salt, why would he delete his stuff? Probably because we knew KJ had a bug up her ass about Salt this whole time. So that, but also if they want to make KJ a witness, and I'll get there, then having those tweets out there and having this fighting might not be super beneficial. We also saw this with Lorianne. We saw Lorianne, I mean, she turned one way and then she turned back around, but we saw Lorianne turn around and give a declaration to Salt. Salt said, hey, thank you, Lorianne, for being a class act. So I wonder if we will see that with KJ. I think that all of this has to do with Swanson. I think the four cease and desist over 18 months, the reason you spend 18 months is because you are trying to get whatever information you want to get without having to sue somebody. I think that we finally got to the point where KJ's lawyers said to Salt, hey, we have a source. So the things that we said weren't in fact defamatory because we have a source. And the Westbrooks said, and your source is whom, please? Because based on everything we've seen, and lots of channels have done videos tying these things together, but all of the statements that KJ made indicated to me and others were on this train of thought with me, like choo-choo, that Swanson was her source, that he seemingly asked her to promote the business partner lawsuit and may have been feeding her information about the Westbrooks. If that is true, then there is a huge issue in the business partner's suit for Swanson, a huge issue. And if that is true, I expect that we'll see Swanson get sued or countersued by the Westbrooks because he's breached his duty to Halo Beauty and potentially defamed Tati and James Westbrook. Now, I still think that the defamation case against James Westbrook is stronger than the defamation case against Tati Westbrook. I've said that since the beginning. I think that the James Westbrook defamation per se, if even with a source after the first cease and desist, you might have been on notice that the source had an issue, that those weren't true statements. So I think there might have been some valid causes there. But if there's a source with regard to Tati Westbrook, it's going to give KJ some defense there saying, no, I was told these things and I had reason to believe these things. So if Swanson's feeding KJ information, I don't know why. And I said this at the beginning, after the first or second cease and desist, you don't just go, hey, it's that dude. Yeah, I want no part of any of this. Y'all, the rich people, you can fight with one another over there in court. I want nothing to do with any of you all. I also think that those who have watched KJ for a long time suspect that she likes being in the middle of a story. She likes to be a part of the action. And there's hubris will catch you in the end. And I think that we got to the point with all the potentially hundreds of thousands of dollars spent on the first wave of the lawsuit, where it is now, okay, I don't want to catch any more of this financially. I don't want to deal with any of this. I'm not going to protect this person who told me the things. And if KJ was protecting Swanson, then that is the thing that the Westbrooks would want. And that is why a mediation makes sense, because then you would have almost a deposition like sit down where you could take under oath statements from somebody and say, okay, what did they tell you? And it's part of settlement negotiation, so it wouldn't necessarily come back up in court. So I think that that's what the Westbrooks wanted. I think that they probably got what they wanted. I think that the settlement agreement has not been finalized yet or signed yet. Remember, it's not just James and Tati Westbrook, but Halo Beauty that has to sign this, which means Halo Beauty's board has to meet. Halo Beauty's board includes still Clark Swanson. So the board has to sit down and agree to enter into this settlement agreement, if there is a settlement agreement, which based on all the statements online, it seems very clear that there is. And then once this happens, I think we'll then see public statements from KJ or Saltz or both saying, or maybe Tati too, saying, we chose to resolve the case. This is why we chose to resolve the case. I imagine what we'll see from KJ is, Swanson told me all along that this was this and I was manipulated and he convinced me. We're going to see, here's speculation. Emily, speculation. We're going to see a breaking my silence style video from KJ. You know where Tati sat down and was like, Jeffrey and Shane told me all this stuff, and because they told me all this stuff, I sat down and filmed my sister. I think we're going to see KJ sit down and be like, Swanson told me all this stuff, and because he told me all this stuff, I said the things I said about the Westbrooks because I believe that they were true. I was led to believe that they were true. I thought I had verified it on my own, and I was used in this infighting between these entities. I think she would have gained more empathy from the internet at large if she had just started with that instead of attacking every channel that reported on the fact that she was being sued. But who knows? So I think we're going to see a breaking my silence. I think we're going to see a breaking my silence. Swanson said this and he told me that. And if that's true, though, if that is true, Swanson breached a whole bunch of duties and is going to get sued up one side and down the other. So we'll see. I think KJ will paint herself as being manipulated in all of this. I think that could have been done after the first, second, third, or fourth cease and desist. I think that's probably what the Westbrooks wanted. I don't ever think they were after money. I think they wanted her to stop making disparaging statements about them, stop, get my name out of your mouth, and give up if somebody's telling you this, who's telling you this? We know that KJ loves to say she has sources. So we'll see. I think if a settlement agreement is signed and reached, we will see her having some room to talk about it, because I can't imagine her signing an agreement where she doesn't get to talk a little bit about her experience or what has happened. And again, fair, like Jeff Wittick talking about his own injury. It happened to you. It's fair that you get to talk about it. So we'll see. And we'll know how it all plays out, because we'll see it play out in the Swanson suit. If there's an amended complaint with counterclaims against Swanson, we'll see them all. We'll see it happen. So I want to see how it plays out. I think there's going to be a settlement based on everything we've seen. I think that the only thing that the Westbrooks could have wanted to settle for is not going to just be a don't talk about us in the future. There had to be more there from it, especially since they don't seem to care about the channel. They don't care about the other things on social. I know a lot of people were calling for her to be deplatformed. Look, you can say what you want to say on the internet. Sometimes there's consequences to saying whatever you want to say, which we'll get into in the next lawsuits that we're talking about today. But that's what I think is going to happen. I think we're going to see statements that a settlement agreement's been reached. I think it's going to take a little time, because remember, the company still has to sign off on that. It's not just Tati and James Westbrook that get to go, yeah, we're settling. I think that we'll see probably a video or two or five from KJ talking about it. I think we'll see a statement from Salt, maybe Tati, though I don't think so. I think it'll probably be from Salt on this. And that's what I think will happen. And I think all of it's going to be like, it was Swanson. I think I said that at the beginning. I've said it the whole time. I still don't understand. These lawsuits were so interwoven that the defamatory statements seemed to be similar to the statements that Swanson was making. And if Swanson was giving those statements to KJ, then Swanson is the source. KJ actually has some defenses to the defamation because there's a source, leaving the defamation very hard to prove against Tati if there is a defense there, which could have come up much earlier in this whole thing. I don't know why it didn't. And still leaving some wiggle room with regard to the defamation per se with regard to James Westbrook. And that's what I think. That's what I think. And then we'll see it play out in the business partner lawsuit, which doesn't have another court date until like September. So that's what it is. That's what I think. And yes, I have not yet asked Salty to have a lawyer chat. We will have a lawyer chat. We might not have a lawyer chat with regard to this case, depending on the terms of their settlement. Most settlement agreements are confidential. Most settlement agreements have very finite terms about what you can and can't say. And most settlement agreements have some kind of a provision or a clause if you violate the agreement. So know that whatever the terms of the agreements are, whatever there is there, they will have to be adhered to, or there will be a consequence. Sometimes that consequence is, and now we can sue you. Sometimes that consequence is, and now you pay us money because you've breached the settlement agreement and there's a lump sum. So there will be some kind of a fallout provision if the settlement agreement isn't adhered to. If the things that we agreed to are not done, then we can do this or this or this. So that kind of ends up being, you know, the thing hanging over KJ's head from the Westbrooks up. If you do these things and do not do those things, then we will not sue you. We will not come after you monetarily, and we will all just move along. So we'll see. We'll see. We'll see. All right. We need to get into, yes, the lightsaber lip gloss. I call it that. Lightsaber is probably a registered mark up one side and down the other of Lucasfilms and now Disney. These are Gingerard lip glosses. It allows you to see there's a mirror. I saw the chat asking about it. I love them. They don't get sticky when I talk. That is what it is. So those are my thoughts. Those are all of my thoughts. Those are all of my thoughts. And will we see Salts getting involved in the lawsuit that's now involving Sherelle's World? Because I saw him tweeting about it too and asking a whole lot of questions. Asking a lot of questions. And does that mean that he is interested in perhaps more YouTube lawsuits? Maybe not the end from Salts. We are following some of his other suits. So I know the channel is deeply entertained by a sassy footnote and a Salty filing, and maybe we will see more. So stay tuned. I think there's more to come on this. I think that we'll see, we'll know when the official settlement agreement is signed because we'll see statements from the parties. That's it. That's it. All right. What should we get into next? Do we want to get into Amanda Ensing, or do we want to get into this slew of people, Amber Sherrington, Andrew Keaton, Young One University, Amanda Grace Crosby, Janelle Evans, Jennifer Kosger Richardson, Fritz Drexler, Joseph Amala, and Joseph Amala suing John Yates, YouTuber, Sherelle Lloyd, Sherelle's World, William Lloyd, aka Perry Sanders, and others. Which one next? Which one next? I'm seeing a lot of Sephora. I'm seeing a lot of y'all saying Sephora. Amanda. Okay, we're going to do Sephora first, and then we're going to do Sherelle's World second, and then we're going to get into questions. So it's a lot, you guys. It is a lot. Let's get into the Amanda Ensing lawsuit. All right, shall we? Shall we? I don't watch Amanda Ensing. Let's just put that out there first. Unlike other cases that I have covered on this channel, I am going into this one without a ton of background information. I know that Amanda Ensing is a conservative beauty influencer who is now suing Sephora for defamation, among other things. I know that there is a, because I Googled, that's about as far as we got. She has a like a video that's on the membership side of the Daily Wire, which is Ben Shapiro's media company, about fighting corporate cancel culture. So I think she very much sees herself as protecting her right to her beliefs, her right to speech. I don't know if she said more than they said she said in this lawsuit, because we'll see. I'll tell you what my thoughts and questions are. But again, not super familiar with her or her content. I believe her Twitter has since been suspended, so I couldn't go back and look at the statements for myself. So we're going with this on the face of this lawsuit that was just filed last week. And this lawsuit was filed in federal court in Tennessee, you know, my new home state. I was unaware that Amanda Ensing lived here. Apparently she's a resident of the fine state of Tennessee. Don't hold that against Tennessee if you are not an Amanda Ensing fan. But here's the thing. People are allowed to have their beliefs. People are allowed to say what they want to say. But it doesn't mean there aren't consequences when you say what you want to say. So we'll see. I want to know what you think as we go through this. Did what Sephora say about her, was it defamatory? Was them breaking their agreement to work with her as an influencer problematic for her? Probably. Was it problematic for Sephora? I don't know. Look, companies have the right to choose who they want to work with, but people are glad Sephora cut ties with her. Yet when we get into the Dave Ramsey lawsuit, people are going to be like, whoa, 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 whoa. Yes, you can choose who you want to work with and how you want to work with them. And we're even seeing people's lives outside of work coming into play heavily in their work. We're seeing this in YouTube with people being demonetized for things that happened off platform, not in their content. We are seeing people being fired for things that are happening outside of work hours. And we're seeing a lawsuit in New York with the Central Park Karen. I literally don't remember the woman's actual name. The woman who called and made apparently a false police report against a bird watcher and said she was part of this ongoing beef between bird watchers and dog owners, and reported falsely that the man who was bird watching, who was Black, was attacking her and that she was terrified and it seemed to be racially motivated. She was fired for that. She's suing her employer saying, you can't fire me for that. And everybody's like, what is this woman doing? But then we see, you know, Dave Ramsey firing employees for, you know, having sex outside of marriage. And people are like, wait, you can't do that either. So there is a very weird blend of where your non-work related shit is affecting your work related shit right now. And I don't know where the stopping point is where your off work life is now affecting your work, because with social media, something that an employee does, like Central Park Karen, can very, very much impact the workplace, where something Amanda Ensing says on Twitter can blow back on Sephora if she's collabing with them. And so we're seeing this push-pull of like, wait, in this situation, that sits weird, but in this situation, I totally get it. And we're going to see this play out, because now Amanda Ensing is suing in Tennessee, and the lawsuit with regard to Dave Ramsey is in Tennessee. And we will be talking about that later this week or early next week. I have to look at my calendar. It's been busy. Let's get into this complaint. Amanda Ensing claims that Sephora and its chief marketing officer made false and defamatory statements online about her, exposing her to public hatred, ridicule, contempt, costing her her business and brand as a social media beauty influencer. I am going to say this throughout this entire thing. I am very curious as to how Amanda Ensing, through her attorneys, are going to prove that it was Sephora's statements that exposed her to public hatred and ridicule, and not her own statements and behavior on social media. That is going to be, for me, the pivot on this case. How do you differentiate public media backlash? And we do see public media backlash coming swift and hot for people, but how do you differentiate the public media backlash because of what she said or because of what Sephora said? And I think that's going to be a difficult thing to prove in this case from first look at this complaint. Again, these are all allegations. People can sue anyone for anything. You can say things in a lawsuit you couldn't just say on the street because of litigation privilege. It doesn't mean that they are true. This is her side. This is their opening shot across the bow. This is Amanda Ensing's perspective of what happened, in sensationalized into a lawsuit. Brief summary of the case. Advertising through social media influencers provides a new means for brands to reach consumers in the modern era. We know what an influencer is, so we are going to keep going. The values at the core of influencer marketing are authenticity and trust by their audiences. I think we're going to see this come into play with her saying she can't not make the statements that she made. She has to make the political statements that she made. She has to be on social media supporting her beliefs. And I believe her channel banner right now says making beauty great again. It is very clear that she is a ongoing Trump supporter. That does not sit well with many, and I get it, but she's going to argue, I have to be true to who I am because that's how I build trust with my audience. So I'm not hiding from them my support of the former president. The issues in this case arise from false and defamatory statements against her by Sephora and its agents. She is a family-friendly social media beauty and lifestyle influencer who's honest with her subscribers. We're going to see that come up a lot, about her Christian and conservative values. I think we're going to see more of these lawsuits. Look, we're going to see this. Yes, we're going to get through the whole lawsuit, but I think we're going to see more of these lawsuits. I have not pulled up the Candace Owen lawsuit, but Candace Owen said she was suing the fact-checking company that works with Facebook. We are seeing Louder with Crowder saying that he is suing YouTube over perceived discrimination or silencing. I think we are going to see more of these types of lawsuits, and my question is going to remain the same. Can businesses choose who they work for? Are businesses discriminating based on political beliefs or conservative values? Or are businesses just protecting their bottom line? Like, does Sephora really care if you're Christian or if you're not Christian? I think Sephora cares more that they're getting hate on Instagram and Twitter based on what somebody else said. And they're like, yeah, we don't want any of that at all. We're stepping away quietly and quickly, and obviously not quietly because now we're in a defamation suit. So I think we will see more of these. I think we will see more of these lawsuits playing out in the courts. In early 2021, Sephora defamed Ensing as the company issued a statement across its social media platforms, including the company's largest Instagram, spreading defamation across its over how do you spread defamation across? Sorry, word choice. Spreading the defamatory statement to its 20.7 million followers. You see that I have questions. I have questions. What did they say? Date of the post, content of the post. They get into it later, but I would have liked to have seen it here. These are stylistic nitpickiness, but now I'm curious. I'm like, wait, no. What did they say? Like, don't leave me hanging, bro. What did they say in their post? You are telling me the case. Tell me the story in a way that I can understand. She suffered backlash of severe, sustained, and aggressive abuse online that made news on several internet media sites, further spreading the false and defamatory statements. The backlash was a direct result of defendant Sephora's defamatory remarks aimed at driving her out of the beauty industry. It's interesting to say Sephora's goal was to drive her out of the beauty industry versus Sephora's goal was to stop their own hatred coming at them, saying, stop working with Amanda Ensing, but okay. The footnote says each of the following sites covered plaintiff's severance from Sephora, including cosmeticbusiness.com, insider.com. Of course, Insider covered it. The Insider team covers all manner of influencers. Glossy.com, NewYorkPost.com, TheHill.com, Team Vogue, Distractify, FoxBusinessNews.com, AU, The Daily Beast, Influence, The Sun, Movie Guide, and PR News, among others. So now they're saying, look, they made this public statement and then it was signal boosted everywhere, making the defamation worse. Defendant Sephora defamed Ensing, stating, here we go. Stating Ensing made light of the violence and tragic loss of life at our nation's capital last month. Sephora and its agents falsely claimed Ensing supported violent or racist ideology. Those assertions are categorically untrue. Ensing's comments on social media never made light of violence. In fact, she reportedly disavowed violence and called for peace. So this looks like it is all stemming from statements Ensing made on social media regarding the insurrection at the Capitol. My question here was, did she say anything during this time that also could have caused the backlash? Because how do you parse Sephora's statement causing the backlash, not her own statements causing the backlash? That is going to remain my question in all of this. Sephora's chief marketing officer stated in an email to, quote, all members of the Sephora employee community that Ensing, quote, used her platform to share or highlight racially insensitive and discriminatory language and made light of the violence at our nation's capital. This further act of defamation continued to disrupt Ensing's position in the beauty community, causing further damages. And then they say, but for the defamation and the charges here, she would not have suffered this backlash. The parties are Ensing, an individual natural person and citizen of the United States and state of Tennessee, defendant Sephora USA Inc., a Michigan corporation. You don't need to know where Sephora is located. If you care, it's in there. The defendant, who is Sephora's chief marketing officer in her individual and representative capacity. What they mean by that is they're suing her as a person for making the statements, but they're also suing her as the chief marketing officer making those statements. Plaintiff is unaware of the true names of the additional does. So others, does 1 through 1,000 also helped in this. What they go on about with that later on in this suit is that there might be others at Sephora that sat down and had board meetings that decided to release this statement. And they might have also been part of the decision to release the statement that they released that Ensing and her attorneys are saying is defamatory or are alleging is defamatory. Jurisdiction and venue. The court has subject matter jurisdiction over the minimum amount of $75,000. That is a statutory amount saying, hey, we get to be here in federal court. She's in Tennessee. Sephora is a corporation. Jurisdiction's not going to be too much of an issue here. Sephora has stores in Tennessee. I can say this with confidence because I have been to them. So Sephora avails itself of Tennessee courts by having a business presence in the state of Tennessee. I doubt that they will fight on jurisdiction, but just for those of you that have been around for a while, here's International Shoe. Hello, International Shoe. So good to see you in this jurisdiction clause. This court has personal jurisdiction over defendants as all defendants have availed themselves of the benefits of conducting business in Tennessee, thereby satisfying the minimum contacts necessary. From International Shoe, if you would like a more thorough discussion of International Shoe, see all of the videos regarding the jurisdiction in the Tati Westbrook case. moving on past jurisdiction, statement of facts, Ensing is a young Latina woman who prior to January 29th, 2021, was known for family-friendly beauty and makeup videos on YouTube and Instagram. She had approximately 1.4 million subscribers. Has her sub number dropped on YouTube and 1.4 million followers on Instagram and generated approximately $100,000 a month in revenue from beauty product sponsorships alone? Let's just take a minute to talk about what that means. $100 million a month from sponsorships. That's not including AdSense. That's not including if there's merch. I'm not familiar with her content. That is from sponsorships, $100,000 a month. So that's over $1 million a year in just sponsorships, not AdSense. I don't know what kind of views her videos get. Let's see. We're going to Google. I'm curious as to whether or not her sub numbers have gone down. Let's see what it says on the front end. It says 1.41 million subscribers. So it says, it indicates that we still have 1.41 million subs, and that's not a lot. I was looking for a thumbnail yesterday. You can see that I was looking for thumbnail images. It came from this video. When you look at the thumbnail of my video. But in the 20,000 view range, which, you know, is a little for a 1 million a 1 million sub channel, seems average for her, but can be a little bit on the low end for her sub base. So I don't know if that is before or after, because these are closer to the 100,000s. I don't know. If the What's Next for America 6 months ago is getting you 200,000 views, just like lead in at some point. So we will see. But that seems to be about average viewership. 50,000, 37,000. We're not doing a channel review, but it seems like these numbers for average videos that don't like pop are consistent. So side note and a tangent. Let's get back into this lawsuit. It seems that the video numbers are consistent. So she is saying, Ensing is saying that she worked with defendant Sephora on approximately 3 collaborations, that she was diligent and loyal, that she received substantial praise for the quality of her vlogging work with Sephora, that she was never disciplined or suspended during her time at Sephora as a retail associate. I didn't know she actually worked for Sephora or vlogging for Sephora as a brand influencer on YouTube. On the morning of January 6th, Ensing posted a picture on Twitter of then President Donald Trump with the caption, "It will be biblical. It will be biblical." I mean, that's not going to age well. Nope. As the day went on, I'm sure that did not go well over on the Twitters. Ensing was vocal about the future of America under President Biden. Quote, "There's not enough popcorn in the world for what's about to happen." I could see that being read as a big problem as an insurrection is starting. I can see it. But also, hindsight being what it is, I don't know what time any of these were posted. So it's hard to say when these were posted and if these were all that was posted, because this is all her attorneys are choosing to share. We don't know what else was posted. I'm sure it's somewhere on a Reddit. I don't know. She tweeted adding, "This is referring to the amount of corruption about to be revealed in our government. As usual, the left twists our words." So it looks like there's not enough popcorn in the world for what's about to happen did not hit well. And this was, no. I'm talking about Joe Biden. I'm not talking about the Capitol insurrection. But without timestamps, it's hard to know. As the events of January 6th unfolded and more violence, including the tragic loss of life, was reported in the media and on social media, Ensing tweeted, pray for justice and truth, pray for protection and safety. We need peace. Ensing called for people to pray and for justice, shared several Bible verses, and maintained she did not condone the violence at the Capitol. To clarify, this was not condoning violence at the Capitol. Violence is never okay. I mean, is she clarifying the "it will be biblical"? I need to see the tweet. I have questions. I have so many questions. They're saying she said violence is never okay, no matter which party it is. I was referring to corruption I believe will be exposed in the coming weeks. and would be set in stone after certification of a rigged election. There it is. That was not my intention. I don't know. Are these? Yeah, I was going to say, I thought her tweets weren't there. So don't give me a link that doesn't work. Me getting sassy about wanting to see all the things. On January 11th, Reward Style Inc. on behalf of defendant Sephora contacted her to use her beauty influencer status to promote Sephora. So then they did a collab. They agreed to it on January 21st to one dedicated Sephora video titled 10 Sephora Skincare Gems You Need in Your Life. I don't know if that's still up, but that would have been January 21st, 2021. Where she listed her favorite skincare products from Sephora. She did the brand collaboration. The contract contained a moral character clause. This is going to come up more and more. I've talked about this in relation to other influencer agreements. I speculated about this with regard to James Charles and whether there was this type of a clause with his work with Morphe when they ended up going separate ways or phasing out or whatever they said. We're going to talk about this with regard to the Dave Ramsey lawsuit, with regard to their righteous living policy, but a morality clause is not uncommon. A morality clause is something that we can expect in influencer agreements, because that's something that can happen. You can have brands saying this doesn't meet our values, and if this doesn't meet our values, we have a right to move away, and that is perfectly fine. So the brands are allowed to have morality clauses. Will we see influencers pushing back on morality clauses if needed? Maybe. Will we see brands making sure that their morality clauses are much more parsed out and much more clear about what they contain? Maybe. But I think this is something we're going to see more of in the future. And we see it on YouTube with YouTube, as I pulled this lawsuit back up and continued rambling, we're going to see it on YouTube too, where we see the creator kind of code of conduct, and we see channels being demonetized for things that happen off platform. And at some point, there's this balance between what is private life, what is personal life, what is business, and what is not. And I'm just going to take a minute with the chat. Y'all. We are not here to judge anyone's values. We are not here to argue over who's right and who's wrong. We're talking about whether this is a lawsuit. And if you all fight the chat, we'll just turn it on to members only. And we absolutely will. Because if we are not judging anyone's viewpoints at all. That's not what this is about. This is about whether a company has the right to have a clause where they say, this is what we're doing, this is not what we're doing. Do companies have that right? Do companies have the right to talk about what is happening outside of their business? Do companies have a right to say, can you, if you tweet this, you don't get to work with us? Do companies have a right to fire someone for having premarital sex, like in the Dave Ramsey case? Where are we allowed to live our private lives, and where does the private life clash with our public and work life? And when you're an influencer, I think that line is more blurry than when you're an employee, because when you're an influencer, your workspace is very much on social media. But does Sephora have the right to say, this doesn't work for us? So we are not here to argue over any of what happened on January 6th on who's right and wrong in all of this. This is whether it's defamatory or whether a brand has the right to walk away. That's it. So please, please don't fight with each other in the chat, or We will just turn it off and continue talking about this because the chat is a place for discussion. It's not a place for name calling. It's not a place to fight it out. You guys, we have built a community of law nerds that have different points of view, and we are not hostile to different points of view, just like we're not hostile to each other. And I know that that can be hard when we're talking about politics. I know it can be hard. People are allowed to have different political beliefs. They are. You might not like it. People are allowed to think differently from you. That's okay. But what we're not going to do is fight over it in the chat, because what we are seeing play out in this lawsuit is someone saying, can I have an opinion online, and can a brand then stop working with me? Speech can have consequences. And that's what we're talking about. Speech can have consequences, and speech in the chat can have consequences too. So thank y'all for keeping the chat not Thunderdome, because that is what we do in our chat. And we will continue on talking about the lawsuit. But you guys, our chat is full of people with widely different political beliefs. So, you know, we are going to be open and welcoming to all. We are not going to be hateful on any side. And being hateful to people because they're conservative is just as dumb as being hateful to people because they are liberal. So we are moving on. Don't make me turn the car around. We will have nice things if we can talk about the facts of this case. And look, if Amanda Ensing, if you don't like her and you don't like her beliefs, I totally get it. I completely get it. But what if Amanda Ensing was advocating for something that you liked? What if she was advocating for a position that you stood behind? If Amanda Ensing was removed from a company because she was standing behind trans rights or behind gay rights or was at a BLM rally on the other side of this, then this conversation still happens the same way. What if a company said, I saw you at this protest or this rally, and therefore we are no longer working with you as a individual or as an influencer? I think then people would be outraged in a different way. I get it. So we are, look at this in both sides and be like, look, is what you do online as an influencer something that can affect your work? Yes. I think more clearly than if you're an employee. And that's what we're talking about. Where is the line of what's right? So where is the line of morality clauses and what you are and aren't allowed to say? And where is the line on what companies are allowed to do? And what's the line on defamation? So let's keep moving on with this. So that we have gotten to the morality clause or the moral character clause, which provided that defendant Sephora could, at its discretion, terminate the contract if the clause was violated. This is something that's going to become more and more prevalent, I think, in working with influencers, because we're seeing this with James Charles, right? James Charles basically admitted to inappropriate texting with minors. Companies are allowed to say, yeah, we're not doing that. So you see this in other ways playing out. So let's get to the rest of this. Ensing specifically inquired about the purpose behind the clause because she had previously been criticized for her Christian conservative values. So she is saying that she perceives she was being singled out, perhaps, because of this. I imagine that Sephora has probably put a moral character clause into all of their influencer agreements at this point. So she said she was told that it was not a problem and would only ever be referenced in extreme situations such as violence or hate speech. So clearly, they were, I think Sephora is going to say down the road that they saw her tweets falling into these circumstances. She's going to argue that they didn't and that Sephora defamed her, but it's going to be really tough with a moral character clause in the contract. And without seeing the contract, we don't know. Specifically, the clause states that defendants Sephora and Reward Style can terminate the project and therefore not pay NSYNC and require her to remove the video if she's involved in any situation, past or present, that offends, insults, or causes public scandal. Well, I wasn't around following her or following along with her or paying attention to her when all this went down. Did her statements cause a public scandal? And if her statements caused a public scandal, then is Sephora within its rights to terminate the agreement? Probably. But that isn't what they're being sued over. And they're not being sued for violating the contract, because I think everyone in this situation goes, it might have caused a public scandal. And if it caused a public scandal, you're within your rights to violate to void the contract or to step away from working with her, as any company is in the right to do if they're doing that in a non-discriminatory fashion. But however, Amanda Ensing at the heart of this is suing over the statement Sephora released, saying that that statement was defamatory, not that they couldn't break the contract with her. So I think everybody agrees the company was in their right to stop working with her. It's what they said about stopping working with her that was the problem. She's not arguing that Sephora should have kept working with her. She's arguing that what they said created more of a problem. So on January 28th, 2021, NSYNC submitted the video for review. They said they loved the video. On January 29th, the initial reprisals were sparked when NSYNC posted the Sephora-sponsored video. A Twitter user named Radical Justice began to, they say, falsely claim on the comments of the video that NSYNC spread hate and misinformation. On January 30th, it's interesting to me, by the way, that they're pointing out one Twitter user. Like, did one Twitter user create the maelstrom that Sephora responded to? And if so, is Sephora really responding to one Twitter user? I can't imagine there was just the one, but I guess we'll find out in time to come. Radical Justice said, I'm incredibly disappointed to see you're sponsoring people like at Amanda Ensing. She is spreading hate and misinformation. I imagine that is regarding her statements about the stolen election, if I had to guess and extrapolate. Other users also repeated these false claims and engaged in name calling, never okay, derisive comments, and extremely disruptive social media posts about Ms. Ensing. So there were more. Sephora immediately responded to the comments on both Instagram and Twitter 4 days after the post. This is now a blogger and not just when did we go from anonymous Twitter user to blogger? I am confused, but okay. Now we're a blogger. All right. Defendant Sephora stated as follows. We get to the whole statement. Here is the statement that is alleged to be defamatory. We were recently made aware of concerning behavior by Ms. Ensing. Did you not look at her Twitter before you signed this agreement at the end of January? Because it seems like she would have been talking about this in the beginning of January. But okay. We were recently made aware of concerning behavior by Ms. Ensing on her social platforms. Most recently, she made light of the violence and tragic loss of life at our nation's capital last month. For this reason, we made the decision to cease all programming with her indefinitely, including having the video she created through an external vendor taken down. So they made it clear that they didn't work with her directly, that they were working with her through a third party, which isn't uncommon in the world of influencers, that you have these kind of placement agencies. What's the name of this one? That you have a placement agency that's placing the sponsorship, and that was through Reward Style Inc. That's not uncommon that there's a third party that does it. So they're taking objection to she made light. Now, is that Sephora's opinion? Because we're going to get really into the realm of, is this a malicious untrue defamatory statement, or is this an opinion? Is this an opinion? Do they believe that she made light? Because tweets can be read a million different ways. I think this is going to be very hard for them to prove that Sephora isn't stating their opinion that she made light of the violence and tragic loss of life. Because she's going to argue my tweet meant this, and Sephora's going to argue we read it as this. So from that, Ensing was ostracized, belittled, disparaged, and received death threats based on the false claim that she made light of tragic loss of life. Well, or was it based on her own statements? And again, you have the right to say whatever you want to say, but the right to say what you want to say is not free from consequence. So was the backlash and response she received, again, from her own statements or from Sephora's statements? And I think it's going to be very, very, very difficult to parse the two of those. This false claim was repeated numerous times, they're saying, including on Instagram, and then picked up by national media like Insider and Teen Vogue. The publications included several false and defamatory allegations concerning the company's decision to stop working with her. Well, if this is the entire statement, what's the defamation? The defamation would be she made light of the violence and tragic loss of life. But also, is that an opinion? And let's keep going. Defendants knew their defamatory statements were untrue and intentionally willful with malice disregard of the truth. This is stating out the elements of defamation and accepting the fact that Ensing is going to be a public figure. That's why malice is stated. They will probably try to argue that she's not, but I think that that's going to be a hard argument if they do try to argue that she is not a public figure. So let's go on and see what their arguments are. First, defendants accused Ensing of sharing content that was not aligned with Sephora's values around inclusivity. This is a false statement based on defendants' own definition of inclusivity. Really? Sephora is allowed to state what its values are. Okay. But Sephora, they're saying, defines inclusivity as challenging racial bias, supporting equity, justice, and inclusion, and creating fair and anti-racist working environments. Therefore, this allegation conveyed. So they're saying that, arguendo, saying that she did not meet their definition of inclusivity, that she is then, in fact, opposed to those things, that she then supports racial bias and racist working environments. We're going to stretch. Even a cursory review of Ensing's social media content reveals that she never supported racism or bigotry. Indeed, as defendants are well aware, Ensing herself is a Latina and fights in her life against racism and bigotry. So they're arguing that Sephora saying that her content was not aligned with their values of inclusivity is defamatory because it's calling her a racist. I think it's a stretch. Who is going to Sephora's definition and saying, oh, Sephora must mean that? Second, defendant accused Ensing of making light of the violence. We've covered that thoroughly. For example, on 11-12-20, she tweeted, no one, literally no one, should be attacked or have to apologize for who they have voted for. On 11, so we're getting into November. On 11-15-20, she tweeted, equality and love for everyone on January. So they're going through her tweets again, or her Instagram, saying that she doesn't condone violence. Okay. Third, I cleaned up the typo. Defendants claim that Ensing was an inappropriate partner for defendants' brand. They're allowed to make that statement. They're allowed to say that. The third allegation is merely a not so subtle reformulation of the first allegation and is provably false and defamatory. So her not being a fit for their brand is now defamatory, according to them. Fourth, defendant chief marketing officer made false and defamatory statements about NSYNC in her capacity, sending an email saying she used her platform to share highly racially insensitive and discriminatory language. Again, is that an opinion that she used her platform to share or highlight racially insensitive and discriminatory language? Is it an opinion about what constitutes insensitive and discriminatory language? I think it's perhaps an opinion. And made light of the violence at our national's capital last month. Again, it's hard. I think it's going to be hard to argue that these are statements of facts, but we will see. Then they go ahead and refine or redefine defamation. A communication is defamatory if it tends to so harm the reputation of another as to lower their esteem. Yeah, but it has to be a false statement and it can't be a statement of opinion. But thank you for the restatement second on torts. Much appreciated. They talk about the false statements causing her YouTube channel to lose 1,400 subs on January 29th, that defendant is a dominant force that destroyed her reputation and was a major source of her income, that others have stopped working with her. They talk about her suffering psychological and emotional harm as a result of Sephora's statements. See my statements above about whether it was Sephora's statements or her own. Ms. Ensing has been subject to persistent hatred and ridicule on social media following these defamatory statements. Again, how do you know the difference? They go back and talk about her being bullied off of social media. They argue that her Twitter account was suspended. And one user wrote, "I'm so happy we ran Amanda Ensing off social media, Instagram next." And then it talks about people trying to get her deplatformed. I don't know how that is Sephora's fault that others were seeking to deplatform her. That is what is happening on social media. I am sure people reported her to Twitter for hate speech and people reported her elsewhere. I am sure that that did happen, but they're blaming this all on Sephora, ruining her influencer career. It will be interesting to see how that part shakes out and how they differentiate the backlash on her own statements versus what Sephora said. And maybe the differentiation is that the backlash didn't happen until Sephora made the statement and there wasn't a backlash on January 6th. But I suspect that Sephora will say the backlash started before and we just didn't see it. We didn't see it. The third party was vetting her as a influencer. We'd worked with her before with no problems. We didn't see the backlash earlier, but the backlash happened before we even started. So let's get into what the causes of action are real quick. We've talked about defamation so much on this channel. I'm not going to break it down because we still need to get to the other lawsuit. First cause of action, NSYNC against defendant Sephora and Doe's for defamation. We talked about what they said in defaming her or allegedly defaming her up above. Second cause of action against the chief marketing officer of Sephora. Again, in that email that was sent to employees, defamation can be sent to one or two. We saw a case against Kesha, where she had sent a text to Lady Gaga and was found to have defamed her former producer. So how many people it gets sent to is not necessarily the thing. So getting it sent to employees is not going to be a problem. The defamatory statements concerning her referenced her by name. Okay, fine. Next cause of action, false light invasion of privacy. This is, again, another quirk of defamation, saying that it has placed her in a false light, saying she's things that she's not. I think it'll be really interesting to see if we get to a place where in the defamation per se realm, calling people racist starts to come into that defamation per se. It will be interesting to see how the law starts to address this as we keep moving forward. Like, where is the line between defamation per se and name calling? There's a lot of case law with regard to calling people criminals, calling people frauds, things like that, but there's not as much case law with regard to other things. So we will see how this continues to evolve in the realm of not just false light, but in the realm of defamation and defamation per se. defendant's placement of Ensign in a false light is highly offensive to a reasonable person. So them saying that she was not a good fit for their brand was highly offensive, and no reasonable person could tolerate being publicly accused of hate speech and racism. So we'll see if they're going to, Ensign and her team are going to argue that these were thinly veiled ways of accusing her of such. Sephora is going to say, we believed her tweets to say this. This is how they were interpreted by a large number of people based on the comments we received. And we invoked our moral clause, and that's it. Away we go. So that's the false light. Common law and statutory tortious interference with contractual relations. We've talked about this in other conversations, and we've talked about this in other cases. This is her alleging that Sephora's statements made other companies walk away from her as well, that Sephora should have known and that Sephora should have been aware. And so because Sephora should have been aware of her other contractual relationships, their statement was necessarily going to interfere with future brand deals and what have you. So by publishing defamatory statements and placing her in a false light, they knew it would interfere with her business. We'll see. They're alleging they did so with malice. The elements of the crime are all being alleged under these causes of actions because you have to. Ensign against all defendants for interference with prospective business relationships. This is not the ones that exist, but the future ones. Going forward, Ensign against all defendants for conspiracy to defame. This is where I'm getting that. Is she alleging that the Doe defendants were other people in the room that crafted this statement? It was not just the chief marketing officer, but any PR and things like that, where we had to craft this statement. So that is what this conspiracy to defame, the people working together at Sephora all brought this together as well. And then prayer for relief is just an amount to be determined at trial, injunctive relief prohibiting the defamatory statements. I mean, the shit's already out of the horse on that one. And that's the hard thing about defamation. With defamation, once it's out, and it's really hard to rail that back in. So, okay, you can have an injunction. I don't know how much good it's going to do. Costs associated with this action, legal fees, and any other further relief signed by the attorneys. I just take issue with the fact that they signed it attorneys for defendant. You're the plaintiff. You can copy and paste your footer all day long, but just make sure you've got the party right at the end. Just the basics. Just make sure it says attorneys for plaintiff at the end, because you are the one suing. You're suing them. You're not the attorneys for Sephora. You are suing. And that is the defamation suit filed by Amanda Ensign against Sephora. I think that this is not a bright line case by any means. I think that there are some interesting arguments to be made. I think it will be interesting to see how this plays out, because Sephora is going to defend itself saying this was our interpretation and opinion based on what she said. She's going to say, but you basically called me a racist online, and that's defamatory. And we'll see how it plays out. I think this one's going to play out for a while. I really do. I think we're in it for the long haul on this. Could they settle behind the scenes? Absolutely could. I don't think she filed this to settle behind the scenes. I think she wants to play this out publicly. Because again, with lawsuits, there's always a PR component. So we will see. Is this someone being discriminated against for conservative beliefs? Or is this a corporation saying, we have the right to choose who we work with, and that shit you said wasn't okay with us? We're going to see how it plays out. And there's a bunch of these cases coming. The Crowder case, they say it's going to be coming. I think the Dave Ramsey case plays into this too. It's, again, I've said it 700 times, what you do in the workplace, what you do outside of the workplace, and how private life and brand deals kind of come together. But this isn't really private life, because She's a social media figure. She's an influencer. So what you say online has impact and has weight. And sometimes companies are going to say, yeah, but it's a no. It's a no for me. It's a no for me. And they're allowed to say that. So that is the ensing suit. It's a lot. Like, it's a lot. There's a lot in that suit. It is clearly written though, but you're going to have to just hold on, because this one, not so much clearly written. This is a horse of a different color. This is not clear. This is a mess. And we're going to get into YouTube channels being sued for defamation. Actually, before we get into it, there are over 3,000, almost 4,000 of you in here. If you haven't done the YouTubey things, please do the YouTubey things. Like, subscribe. We break down lawsuits here. We keep it civil in the chat the best that we can. I know the moderators are probably working overtime because people have, when we talk about polarizing creators, there are lots of thoughts about the polarizing creators, but we are trying to have a conversation about facts and not get into the fuckery. So let's continue on. Do the likey things, do the YouTubey things, and let's talk about people talking about people. People talking about people on the YouTube. I don't know who a lot of these people are. I'm just going to make that very clear. So bear with me, as I don't know who a lot of these people are. I'm sorry. I don't. We're not familiar with everyone who does everything. It's just not the way. I got tagged in this a bunch on Twitter. This was filed May 18th. So not that long ago, but I got tagged a bunch as this broke. Now, who is suing? There's a whole bunch of people suing a whole bunch of people. I think it's a mess. I think it's probably going to be a mess. I think, we'll get into the issues as I repeat myself 700 times. Amber Charrington, Andrew Kenton, Young One University LLC, Amanda Grace Crosby, Janelle Evans, who I think is from Teen Mom, Jennifer Kosher Richardson, Fritz Drexler, Joseph C. Alamia P. LLC, which indicates a law firm, and Joseph C. Alamia versus John Yates, who I Googled is a YouTuber. Sherelle Lloyd, who is a YouTuber from Sherelle's World. William Lloyd, her husband, who is Perry Sanders. And Jane and John Doe's 1 through 20. This complaint is a mess. It's a mess. It's a mess. So, YouTube channels being sued by a grip of people involved, I think, in the TLC reality world. So, let's just try to parse it the best we can. We're going to have to deep dive this if you want, but this, we're just going to hit the high points. So I see somebody, Sophia, saying PLC is a partnership LLC. PLLCs can also be professional limited liability corporations, which is why I say I think that that is a law firm, because it will come up later in the suit. So PLLCs in some states are professional limited liability corporations. This is not written well. This is not written well. Let's just start there. Okay. Plaintiff Amber is a resident of Salt Lake City. I really wish you would say who the people are, at least in the Amanda Ensing suit. Look, y'all might not like this suit at all, but it's well written. It's clear. We understand what's happening. When they get to the parties, Amanda Ensing is an individual, natural person, citizen, the state of Tennessee, defendant, Florida, defendants. And then it gets into who they are when we get to the facts. Why is it statement of facts? We get to who they are. I don't think we ever get to who they are in this. But Amber is a resident of Utah. Andrew is a resident of California. Young One University LLC is a California company. Amanda Grace Crosby is a resident of Colorado. Jennifer Kosher, I think that's pronounced correctly, but probably not. Richardson is a resident of Indiana. Janelle Evans, North Carolina. Fritz Drexler, Florida. Joseph Ciamala, PLLC, is a limited liability company in Utah. Joseph Ciamala, Alamia. I'm going to get that wrong the entire time. No disrespect intended. We're just. Salt Lake City, Utah. Defendant Yates, New York. Defendant Sherelle, Nevada. Sherelle's World is her channel. Nevada. Perry Sanders, married to Sherelle, Nevada. Under Federal Rules of Civil Procedure 23A, 1 through 4, plaintiffs are numerous and in different states. They're trying to make this a class action defamation suit against diverse defendants. And I just don't know how we're going to get how are we going to get there? I don't know. We're going to take a journey together and we're probably not going to get there. Just what is even happening? Finally, the lawsuit may be brought in federal court in any of the jurisdictions, and the plaintiffs and their counsel will fairly and adequately protect the interests of the class. We have talked about class actions here before, but you have to define the class, and we never define the class. FRCP 23B1, a class is appropriate because I am going to disagree. 23B, plaintiffs are seeking injunctive relief against the defendants, but it doesn't define A, who the class is. Y'all remember in the Kanye West Sunday Service lawsuit that's a class action, and they say the class action is all of these employees who were backup dancers, and all of the backup dancers worked these hours through these hours and didn't get breaks and whatever. And we're naming these Amanda Ensign case is still in my brain. We're naming these dancers, but we're not naming these other dancers because there's other people in the class that we're going to be like, y'all, come here. You also didn't get lunch breaks and overtimes and whatever. So come on in, join our class. Y'all can sit with us. We're all suing Kanye together. Let's go. There's no undefined members of the class. There's no definition of the class. There's no way to know what the class is. Like, who are these people and what are they suing? And what is the common statement that affected all of them? This feels to me like a cluster of various individuals who didn't want to undertake the expense, my opinion, didn't want to undertake the expense to sue people independently, because I imagine that they would need to sue. And as we get into this, this is where we're going. They would need to sue John separately from Sherelle, and each of them, I mean, maybe the company and the individual, but all the behaviors are different. This is not a class action lawsuit. I'm moving on. I don't think it's a class action. I don't think you can have these two defendants together. So like the Triller case, I think we have improperly brought defendants together. Let's get into jurisdiction. Pour one out for jurisdiction on this case, by the way, because woof. Oof. The court has subject matter jurisdiction. Okay, the controversy is over $75,000. They're trying to say that they have subject matter jurisdiction. Let's get to personal jurisdiction. Upon information and belief, this court has personal jurisdiction over defendant Yates, Lloyd, Sherelle's World, and Sanders, and the Does, based on their continuous and systematic minimum contacts with residents of Utah. Through the distribution and targeting of Utah and online content, and defendants have caused injury in the state and the district despite notice that they were infringing on plaintiffs' rights and putting them on notice through a cease and desist letter. And therefore, they are present in this judicial district and transact business and solicit business in the state of Utah within this district and elsewhere. Look. In the last lawsuit we talked about, in the Ensign lawsuit that we talked about, Sephora has businesses. They have actual physical locations in Tennessee. They ship goods, I'm sure, to Tennessee. Well, no, I've had things shipped. So yes, they ship goods to Tennessee. I can say that with certainty. They actually do business within the state of Tennessee. But how do we feel about saying a YouTuber that's sitting in not Utah, is directing their behavior at Utah. Well, we went through all of this in the Tati Westbrook case. We went through the analysis of personal jurisdiction, and I think they're going to have less comments here and less contacts here than we saw there, based on the amount of information we saw KJ seeking in Washington. And the court was like, yeah, so not enough. So not enough. So they're saying these are continuous and systematic minimum contacts with Utah based on what? Based on what? You're going to need facts to back this up. Based on research, based on viewership, based on what? I don't think we're going to get here. I don't think we're going to get here on jurisdiction. I don't think we're going to get here on jurisdiction. I just don't. Further upon information and belief, Yates and Sherelle's World, I'm lumping all the Sherelle's World defendants together under her channel because it's Sherelle, Perry, and her channel. So we're just lumping them together. Have committed tortious acts in the state of Utah. They've gone to Utah and done things, or they've said things on the interwebs. I'm going to need some clarification. And or have committed tortious acts without the state of Utah and engages and or engaged in other. What does that sentence even say? In other persistent courses and conduct and or derives substantial revenue from their online live discussions or posting on their sites, including but not limited to Twitter, YouTube, and Instagram, and derives substantial revenue from interstate commerce. In addition, plaintiffs have been injured in this judicial district. The injury is not going to be enough. That's for sure. This sentence is a mess. But if they're going with the substantial revenue, we're going to run into some problems. We're going to run into some problems with jurisdiction. So my notes in the quarter were, oh, jurisdiction. Oh, jurisdiction. Oh, my, my, my. Oh, my, my, my. This court has specific personal jurisdiction. The reason they're talking so much about jurisdiction is because it's going to be a big fucking problem. Specific personal jurisdiction under Utah's long-arm statute. And then they define the long-arm statute, which looks a lot like what? Washington's long-arm statute, which looks a lot like what? International shoe. High five. You got it. High five. High five. Yes, Diva View. Yes. Yes, Diva. Oh, Perry the Platypus. Because defendants have transacted business within Utah. Oh, really? How? I would like the facts. How? How have they transacted in Utah? Two, have contracted to supply services or goods in Utah. How? Have caused injury in Utah. That might be true. If somebody's feelings were hurt in Utah, if somebody lives in Utah, if the alleged defamation was hurled at Utah, we'll see. But they're saying there's a lot of people in a lot of different places. So is the main person in Utah? Are the main statements in Utah? I don't know. They have caused injury within Utah through their tortious acts. Jurisdiction based on defendants' contacts with Utah, including operation of their interactive websites, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube. Oh, yeah, jurisdiction is going to be a problem. And the reason I was giving jurisdiction a more of a chance in the Tati Westbrook case, A, there were four cease and desist. B, there were specific videos and statements talking about Washington, research in Washington, family in Washington. There was a lot of contacts with Washington. And you know what the court said in that case? Yeah, that shit's still not enough. So, okay, hold on. We're going to go to DEFCON Red for jurisdiction on this because we're there. Like, just file it where one of these people live. But then if you file it, oh, hello, John Yates. Never been to Utah. Not once ever. See, It's interesting how they're doing that, trying to say it. So I just think we're going to have a huge problem with jurisdiction here. They could have picked where somebody lived. They didn't. Jurisdiction's going to be an issue. There are other issues for sure, but jurisdiction's going to be an issue. Yep. Yep. General allegations, plaintiff Richardson information. Okay, which one is plaintiff Richardson? Look, I need a flow chart for this case. I don't know who Plaintiff Richardson is. This one, Jennifer Kosher Richardson. All right. Jennifer Richardson. We don't know who she is. We don't know her, but we're going to find out. Hopefully, clearly. Flash forward. I've read this. It's not clear at all. In late January 2020, Richardson and her husband allowed defendant Yates and his husband to move into their Indiana home. You know what that doesn't say? Anything about Utah. If the crux of the action is stemming out of Indiana, why are we in Utah? During an encounter with Yates, he threatened Richard again. Note, as we're talking about another lawsuit, anyone can say anything in a lawsuit. Lawsuits are very stressful for the parties involved. Lawsuits can be expensive. Lawsuits suck to go through. Allegations are just allegations. We don't know if any of this is true. We don't know what happened. This is what the plaintiffs, and there are lots of them, are saying that the defendants, and there are a number of them, did. So we're going to try to parse this statement of facts. The general allegations, they are, they're poorly written and they're tough to get through. So we're going to try our best to stumble through it and figure this out. So, allegations. During an encounter with Yates, he threatened Richardson, stating he would file a CPS report against plaintiff and her husband. That sounds like it happened in Indiana, not Utah. They say claiming that she and her husband, he would make a false claim of abuse and neglect against her children, which ended their tenancy. So it looks like when that conversation allegedly happened, that was the end of that, that situation where they were living together. On February 13th, 2020, the police department appeared at the house stating they received a child neglect report. Sounds like that happened in Indiana. On February 17th, Richardson filed a report against Yates and a trespass warning was issued against Yates. Okay, cool. On or about February 28th, Yates aired and or broadcast a live stream. When lawyers don't know how to YouTube, it makes it hard to read things. It's just a live stream. It's just a YouTube live stream. Went live or live. You could just call it a YouTube live stream. It's really okay. Interactive event/program on YouTube where defendant Yates and his audience discuss topics live, much like we're doing at the moment. He allowed them to make comments well on air that were subsequently recorded and posted to YouTube. That's how that works. On or about February 28th, Yates... what happened on February 28th? Why are we talking about a YouTube live? What was said? Something must have been said. Proceeded to release private information against Richardson and discuss not only the allegations he levied against her, but also telling his fans to call CPS and report claims against Richardson. If that's true, don't do that. Don't weaponize fan bases. Don't weaponize fan bases. Just don't. However, it also sounds like that happened in Indiana. Also, that isn't defamatory. We'll get into the causes of actions later. On March 8th, 2020, defendant Yates went live on an online platform. What online platform? Okay. And accused Richardson of stealing from him and hiding stolen items in her drawers, which was untrue. Okay. And are we saying that it's defamation per se by accusing her of stealing? What? Okay. On March 10th, 2020, Yates released a video on Instagram stating that Richardson was harassing him, then accused her of neglecting and abusing her children, and that she had a drinking and drug problem, which is untrue. Well, if that is untrue, that's going to be a problem. If that statement was made, again, with defamation, you need to know the context of the defamatory statements. And we talked about this in the Shannon Bedore Real Housewife of Orange County defamation case, because in the complaint, they clipped down two statements from a podcast interview, and the complaint made it look like they had happened together. But when you looked at the statements in the summary judgment motion, when the statements were parsed out, that's not actually what they said. They had a different context to them, and context matters in defamation. However, complaints are written in light most beneficial to the person suing. So when I say if true, there also needs to be context. All right, now we're in June 2020. Yates accused Richardson of attempting to, we've got a hard R word, his husband having an affair with another man, and publicly doxed her husband's place of employment and her personal residence to his online viewership. Well, doxing is not defamatory. Doxing is a separate situation. But again, I'm still not seeing a Utah connection here. All of this is in Indiana. Doxing, we don't support doxing ever. Doxing is problematic. Doxing places of employment are problematic. But doxing is also not defamation. If you're going to go after somebody for doxing, go after them for doxing. There are charges for that, if that in fact happened. On October 20th, 2020, Richardson discovered that Yates created a blackmail email account to store information about her prior to Yates's tenancy with her. What is that? What do those words mean? And what does that have to do with anything? What do those words mean? I'm so confused. This is where the murderous conspiracy is. The murderous conspiracy in this lawsuit might be a blackmail email account. Do they mean backup email account? Do they mean blackmail email account? What is a blackmail email account? I'm so confused. You have to explain things. Look, some research attorney is sitting here going, what in the hell is this even? If the research attorney needs a chart, it's not going to go well for you, plaintiff. Because the research attorney is going to be like, I don't have the time to, I don't know what the fuck this is. I don't have time. On October 21st and 24th, Yates went live on YouTube. Look, if you're referring to YouTube lives, refer to them consistently throughout the complaint. That's it. That's it. Went live in an attempt to discredit Richardson and attack her viewership. Her viewership of what? Who is she? We don't even know her. Is she a YouTuber? What viewership are we discussing? You've started in the middle of the story. This is like talking to my 9-year-old when he's really excited about something that happened in like Roblox or Minecraft, and he starts in the middle and I don't know what an ender pearl is. And I'm like, I don't understand you. You've started in the middle and I am missing some substantial background information. We don't understand. I don't understand. Attack her view. Also, how is that defamatory? What attempt? What was said? When was it said? Holy shit. Okay. On October 26th, Yates admitted online in a YouTube live video that was subsequently posted on YouTube. Okay. As a video. I can't look. I am dyslexic and ADHD, and I am not following this sentence at all. We're going to start over. On or about October 26, 2020, Yates admitted online in a YouTube live video that was subsequently posted on YouTube as a video. Was it re-uploaded? Just say re-uploaded. That he gave another fan the information to call ODPD and a second user information to call CPS again. Again, if we're alleging false reports, that's not defamation, is what it's not. On October 30th, Yates appeared at plaintiff Richardson's residence violating the trespass. Again, deal with that with regard to that case, because if that's a separate case, it's a separate case. Why is this here? Why is any of this here? Why is any of this relevant? I don't know how any of this is relevant. On November 19th, 2020, Yates discussed filing another false report to ODPD and CPS. False reports are not defamation. You can deal with false reports I'm so confused. If there are false reports, deal with the false reports. Why aren't you dealing with the false reports? Why is that not being dealt with? Discussed filing another false report to ODPD and to CPS with another guest on his YouTube channel, wherein the guest and an online contributor indicated that they will call CPS. Why is any of this relevant? And report plaintiff Richardson concerning the false abuse and neglect allegations. Yates persists in his misinformation campaign against Richardson. Plaintiff Drexler's information. Okay. Who is Drexler? We're going back to the top. We need a chart. Fritz Drexler. Okay. I don't look in this lawyers. Tell us who the people are. We don't know who the characters are. We're starting in the middle here. We're missing all the information. And now we're just grumpy. I'm on page 8 and I'm grumpy because I have no idea what the fuck is happening. I am so confused. I need a flow chart. If I have to Google this much to figure out who people are, the complaint is not written well. Look, say what you will about Amanda Ensing. Her lawyers wrote a complaint that we can all understand. You want to understand the story, understand what's happening. And when you can't understand the story, it just leads to everybody being frustrated and us being mad. Okay. On October 13th through November 20th, Yates doxed plaintiff Drexler's wife. Well, why aren't you dealing with the doxing then? And why isn't the wife a plaintiff? I have questions. If that is alleged, deal with the doxing. And the wife should be a plaintiff. Okay. Showing that she worked at the Mayo Clinic in the hematology and oncology research departments and called plaintiff a racist and questioned his wife's political views on white supremacy. Okay, well, again, we've talked about this in the Ensing thing. Will that count as defamation at this point? I don't know. I don't know where we are on if this is defamation. Can it damage someone's reputation? Yes. How do you prove if it's true or false? I don't know. Their behavior, I guess. Okay, we're going to continue on. I will pontificate about that later. During the same period, I guess is up above, released the image on Instagram, released his full name, released whose full name? Whose full name did we release? Drexler or the wife? Who are we talking? Okay. Released plaintiff Drexler's image on Instagram and his full name and a video wherein he claims Drexler is racist against persons of color. During the same period, Yates released plaintiff Drexler's wife's name and photograph, her work address and location, asked his followers if they wanted to report her to the Mayo Clinic, and asked them to report her husband, that her husband was a racist, and to describe how that made them feel. During the same period, Yates posted photos of Drexler's 3-year-old child. Well, look, those things may be, if true, defamatory. The doxing can be dealt with separately, and doxing can be a criminal investigation if you're in, depending on what state you're in. Doxing is never okay. Okay. Plaintiff Eason's information. Here we go. This plaintiff, these claims are not at all related to the other thing. I don't know how these are joined together. These are totally separate. Whatever's going on with the Drexler person is completely separate, it seems, from the Richardson stuff. So those are two separate lawsuits. If you want to bring separate lawsuits, those aren't the same lawsuit. You don't get to just throw everybody in and be like, this person said these things about all of us. But that's not a class. That's not the same. Look, Kanye West Sunday Service, all of the dancers are alleging that they were not paid. They were not paid on time. All of the things. They are similarly situated. They had a same event, a same thing, and a same cause of action. This same event is, okay, this person said this about this person and then this is about this person. Okay, well, those two plaintiffs need to sue separately. Those are not the same. Those don't belong in one suit. These are not related. Make it make sense how these are related. Now we're going on to a third person. So, and they're out of order. Like, Can we cover the people in the order? Look, you've listed them in order here. Can we just list them in order down below too to make it easy on everybody? But no. Okay. Who are we talking about next? Eason, this is Janelle Evans. That is the only name I recognize of the plaintiffs from Teen Mom, or was on Teen Mom, or at some point was on Teen Mom. So Evans, Eason, that's who we're getting to next. Sorry for the scroll. That's who's next? Yes. Okay. So far, the first two plaintiffs aren't related at all. Just at all, in my opinion. I don't make it, nothing they have alleged makes them related. It's the same person saying shit about different people, but that doesn't mean it's a class action. That's not how that works. All right, March 31st, 2021. Well, now we're in a totally different year because this is, now we're now. We've caught up to now. So not even the same videos or the same period of time. Oh my God, this hurts my head. Yates posted a YouTube live video that was subsequently posted on YouTube with Tracy Caranzo and talked about Eason's dismissal from her new podcast. Yates called Devin Clegg. Who is Devin Clegg? Why is, what? Who said she was, she who? Oh my God. This feels like when I used to try to tell my parents stories about things that happened in junior high. And it was like, oh my God. And then she said, and then he said, and then he was like, and then she was all, and then he went, and then, oh my God. And then she went, and then them, and then them, and then they said this, and then they said this, and that happened. And my mom would be like, I'm sorry. What? That's how this reads. That's how this reads. And then she said, and then he said, and then I was like, and then he was like, and, Yates called Clegg, who said she who, I'm assuming she, Eason, was at the kickoff event for the Girl Shit podcast. And Yates said that Eason was let go from the podcast. I don't know how that matters at all. Okay. True or not true, not defamatory. Clegg told Yates, she was like, and then he was like, and then she was all. Clegg told Yates that she was hired. She who? She Clegg or she Eason? Okay. That she was hired a month ago for the podcast, but was not aware of Eason's past. I still don't know who she is modifying. Yates said that it was brought up to the management team and that was enough for Eason to be fired, which was untrue, they say, and affected Eason and her business opportunities because Yates made a false statement about her business and prospective business. We're going to need a lot more information than that for that to stick at all. I don't even see a cause of action here just yet. Yates indicated that Eason was let go and was asked not to attend the event due to, I don't even know why there's an apostrophe there. Yates's comments on his live broadcast. So wait, he said that she was asked not to go to the event based on things he said. So, and he stated that when she showed up at the event, she was denied access to the VIP area. So, and was asked to leave or otherwise excused, which was not true. So what? Can we? And? On or about April 1st, 2021, Yates went live on YouTube and subsequently posted, okay, a YouTube video with Lloyd and Sherelle's World. Yates repeated the false statement from the previous night. What false statement? That someone was denied access to a VIP area? Oh my God. Yates repeated a false statement from the previous night about plaintiff Eason being let go due to his statements on the podcast. But is she on the podcast? And about other online celebrities not wanting to work with her. And so who the fuck cares? I mean, clearly the plaintiffs care. I mean, if they cared a lot, they would have maybe filed their own separate lawsuits, but clearly somebody thinks they care. Yates stated that Eason claimed. So he said that she said. Yates said that Eason said that she was not fired and was a producer. So what, he clarified the statement that's allegedly defamatory, which was true. So he said that it was. So why is any of this relevant? If he said that she was not fired and was a producer, and that was true concerning her role on this podcast, then what did it even matter? He said that plaintiff handpicked Clegg to be on the podcast and planned to get her podcast started. So what? How is any of this relevant to anything? Yates read a statement posted by Clegg about not supporting anything Eason and her husband, due to their past, and she would not work with Eason. Okay, but Yates didn't say it. Clegg said it, so who cares?
Oh my God.
Yates can't be held responsible for what Clegg said. And none of that seems to be defamatory. That's Clegg saying, I don't want to be associated with that person. See re-Sephora lawsuit. You're allowed to say, I don't want to be associated with this person. Ugh. Okay. I'm struggling to see the cause of action. This would make a great law school exam. Someone out there, give this to a bunch of 1Ls and say, don't tell them it's a defamation suit. Take out all the references to defamation and give them the fact pattern and say, spot the cause of action and see what people come up with, because this is just a fruit salad of nothing. Oh, it's like a fruit salad that, like, you really want it to have like pineapple and strawberry, but it's all just like melon. Disappointing. And I spilled on myself. That is how riled up we are. Did you see the coffee? Ugh. We have spilled coffee. This is why, when you ask why my merch is black, it's so when I spill coffee on myself live, when I am so annoyed that you can't see it, totally spilled coffee. Oh my God. Okay. We have another plaintiff to get to. So far, none of these plaintiffs are related. I can't even. Have you guys done the YouTube things? Do the YouTube-y, the likey and the thumbs up-y and the subscribe-y things. We're gonna keep plowing through it. Who is Kenton? Let's see. Andrew Kenton. I think he is also connected to the Young One University LLC. So let's get back down to Kenton. Pardon my scroll. Good God in heaven. All right. Kenton, have we gotten to Kenton? No. Almost. Are we done yet? Oh God, no, there's more. Okay. Plaintiff Kenton's information. On April 6, 2021, Yates allegedly went on YouTube Live with defendant Sherelle from Sherelle's World and Sanders and made statements regarding Kenton alleging business fraud, when Kenton received Paycheck Protection Program loan from the SBA for his daycare business. Plaintiff, you. So that must be Young One University. Okay. But how is that related to any of the other shit? At all. How is statements about a PPP loan from April 6, 2021 related at all to any of the other people? How are they related? Somebody tell me. I am so lost. Defendant Yates told, he said that they said, Yates told Lloyd that he went live on YouTube and posted a video on YouTube about Kenton regarding airline tickets he purchased, loans from the government, and his limited liability companies. So what if he told Sherelle that he made a video about it? Who cares? Lloyd then went live on YouTube discussing Kenton and adding that it was a preview for tomorrow's live broadcast because it was a big story and that plaintiff Kenton had been defrauding the government and how Yates, Lloyd, and Sanders need to further discuss the phony loans. Okay, defrauding the government and phony loans, depending on the context, maybe could be an issue because you could kind of get into the realm of defamation per se maybe, but that is not all related to any of the other stuff. So it just doesn't belong in any of this at all. Also, context matters when it comes to defamation. And because there's no direct quotes, links to videos, or even specific links to anything, we don't know. Sanders claimed that Kenton and Kenton's mother were contacting small blogs. What the fuck does it matter? Oh my God. Oh my God. They were contacting small blogs. What? What is happening? What's a small blog? Do people still blog? I guess there are still blogs. Okay. So Sanders said that Kenton and Kenton's mom were contacting smaller blogs to gain attention in an attempt to clean their government fraud. That doesn't even make sense. But Sanders also wanted to remind viewers what Kenton was doing was still fraud. Okay. Lloyd and Sanders headline again. It depends on the way that this is said, because fraud can fall into the realm of defamation per se, but context, again, matters. Lloyd and Sanders' headline for the YouTube episode, is it an episode now? Was this, I guess, video title. It's the video title. Video title. Was Andrew Kenton's daycare is defrauding the government. Well, I could see where that could be problematic if he's not actually defrauding the government, because alleging fraud can be defamation per se. Not saying that it is in this case. We don't know more, but we saw the whole Johnny Depp headline over all of the one headline in the UK that was up for 24 hours. A headline can be a problem, but you then have to prove it's not true. Or they have to prove it's true. Or they have to prove why they thought it was true. Or they have to have a source. Okay. The amount in controversy would be a felony level offense. So they're trying to establish this for defamation per se, it seems. That seems to be the thing here. However, you've now mixed defendants in together that might not be together because the statements are separate. I don't know how you have joint and several liability for separate statements against separate defendants. None of this is related. This all should be a bunch of separate lawsuits. During a live stream on April 6th, Yates, Lloyd, and Sanders revealed the PPP loan documents and his address and falsely claimed that Kenton created you for the purpose of receiving a PPP loan. Well, that's going to be one of the things that comes down to paperwork you did or you didn't, but that's not related to any of the other stuff up above. Kenton established his daycare prior to COVID-19 and the PPP program. Okay, well then it depends on what the statement's like. That's a factual discrepancy that can be sorted out that has nothing to do with any of the other stuff in this lawsuit. Ugh. Yates, Lloyd, and Sanders claimed that Kenton set up the business you for the sole purpose of receiving a PPP loan, which is not true. Yates, Lloyd, Sanders allege that plaintiff Kenton used the PPP loan to purchase airline tickets for the show 90 Day Fiancé. Oh, is somebody on 90 Day Fiancé? Sure would have been helpful if you said who the fuck the parties were so we knew. That would have been helpful. Purchase airline tickets for the show 90 Day Fiancé aired on TLC and viewed on cable. Okay, great. Which was false because the PPP loan did not issue until late July 2020, well after the plane tickets had been purchased. Okay, well then Yates and his company need to yeet out of this lawsuit and go do their own thing with these claims over here. It has nothing to do with any of the other stuff. And if it was a group conversation, then you can say these people were involved in a conversation and during the course of the conversation, these defamatory things were said. But that's a separate lawsuit that has nothing to do with any of these other defendants. Later that same day, Yates went on Defendant Sherelle's World YouTube channel and titled the piece. Well, who titled the piece? Because if it's her channel, she titled it, not him. 90 Day Fiancé's Andrew defrauds the government for business loan, wherein Yates, Lloyd, and Sanders continue to raise the false allegations. Fine. Those are all going to be factual discrepancies. Those can all be there. That section can be its own thing. On or about April 7th, 2021, Lloyd and Sanders went live again on Sherelle's World, repeating the claims. Okay. Claiming Kenton and the business defrauded the government by making false statements on its PPP loan application, which again is a felony offense. The same day, Lloyd indicated to a third party she was attacking Kenton and his business, you, to curry favor with the network, Sharp/TLC, in an attempt to secure exclusive interviews with the participants of its show 90 Day Fiancé. What? Are they? Well, I guess they're trying to assign malice and motive because they're alleging that it's defamatory, but that section can be its own thing. That doesn't relate to any of the other stuff at all. And there is going to be a factual fight over whether that's true or not. And there can be, because defrauding can be defamatory depending on the context. But a lot depends on the context, and it depends on what was said, and it depends on whether it's true or not. And if they're going to argue it's true and we know it's true, then there's a defense to that. Okay. Charrington, Alamia, and Crosby are all lumped together. And I don't know why. But the stuff with regard to this person, Kenton, is all totally separate from all the other shit. This is not a class action lawsuit. These are separate lawsuits clusterfucked into one. For what purpose, I don't know, but it's going to pull them all down with it. Y'all are going to have to try again, because this complaint is not going far. This is a non-starter. On or about April 9th, 2021, Yates streamed live for 28 minutes. You're allowed to do that. You can stream for under 2 hours. We've been going for over 2 hours. Thank you, mods. It's a lot to cram into one live stream. I know. Stream live for 28 minutes on his YouTube channel concerning plaintiffs Crosby, Charrington, Amala, and JCA. As of April 25th, 21, the video had received 4,050 views on YouTube after being posted by Yates. Okay. Yates stated, wait, so we have nothing left to do with Sherelle's World. This makes no, this is so bad. Defending Yates stated that he was not planning on doing a live, but crazy things were going on. Who cares? Regarding online celebrity Devin Clegg and Ji-Hoon Lee. I don't know who is Clegg the one from up above? Clegg's not a plaintiff. Who are Clegg and Ji-Hoon, and why does it matter? They're not plaintiffs. What? Irrelevant. Yates made false statements alleging that Charrington had Ji-Hoon's Line app login and Instagram login, and that she was texting online celebrity Devin, posing as online celebrity. What is even happening? So Yates made false statements alleging that Charrington was impersonating or had hacked Ji-Hoon? What? Okay. And then she said, and then he said, and then she said, and then he said, and then she said, and then he said. This is hurting my brain. Yates falsely stated every time money was low, Charrington would threaten Ji-Hoon to go live on YouTube or Instagram to raise money to defraud the public and Ji-Hoon. That doesn't make sense. I have no idea what you're talking about. Is this complaint trying to say someone was being extorted? And if so, say that though. Yates alleged that Charrington and Alamia had formulated this plan prior to the launch of a GoFundMe account, and that Lloyd would provide additional information on the situation. Oh my God. They say Yates further alleged that Charrington would boast to others that she had been watching Devin for a long time, claim she lived next door to her, and she may or may not have been stalking her, which again is a criminal offense. So now they're saying the defamation is that he may have said that she had said that she was a stalker. I have so many questions. Yates claimed Ji-Hoon removed the GoFundMe. Who cares about the GoFundMe? because he didn't like the threats he was receiving. So are they alleging that she was threatening him? Okay. Yates asserted that he knew there was a laptop left in Korea. I don't understand what any of this has to do with anything. And that Devin had a lot of pictures on the laptop and that he had seen the pictures. What kind of pictures? And who cares? And what? Yates said that there were directives from certain people within Plaintiff Carrington's group telling her to spread revenge pee from the laptop, which is a felony offense. Well, yes, revenge pee is a felony offense. Okay. On April 4th, 2021, Yates further criticized Plaintiff Drexler. Who? Who's Drexler? What? How? When on a YouTube live stated that Drexler, quote, was hideous and that he had glasses and that he had a dick for a nose. Look, what is happening in this lawsuit? Also, hideous is an opinion. Glasses may or may not be a statement of fact and is an opinion. And saying that somebody has a dick for a nose is not defamatory. It's hyperbole. You're allowed to be rude. Also, it's ridiculous. Oh my God. But it's in a lawsuit. Dick for a nose. Dick for a nose is in a lawsuit. Dick for a nose is in a lawsuit. Thank you, Jammy. Dick for a nose is in a lawsuit. Dick for a nose. Dick for a nose. I don't know who Drexler is, though, and why that has anything to do with the other people and a GoFundMe. But okay. Yates stated that Drexler went to live with Ji-hoon and alleged that Charrington wrote a script for them and scripted out the live broadcast. I don't know why any of that's defamatory. Yates alleged that Crosby was guilty of fraud. Okay, fraud might be a problem. Once again, we talked about defamation per se. Yates stated that the title of the GoFundMe account had already changed three times. Who cares? And that Charrington, who's Crosby? And Alamia and JCA were defrauding people. The amount of $16,000 defrauding may be a problem, which is a felony offense in Utah and was directed specifically at plaintiff Alamia's professional license and plaintiff JCA's business. Yates, they say, indicated that the money plaintiff Crosby, Charrington, Alamia, and JCA made from PayPal, Cash App, and Venmo equaled $16,000, but he stated that he estimated it was closer. Who cares what the amount is? Yates claimed on another YouTube Live on what date that Charrington, Crosby, and Alamia were shady as fuck. Okay. Somebody's shady and has a dick for a nose. I don't know what I... Okay. In the chat comments during the April 9th, 2021 YouTube Live, someone pointed out that misappropriation of funds will get an attorney disbarred and proceeded to claim the plaintiff would be disbarred. And Yates stated this as well. What? Also, what somebody said in the chat is not something that Yates said. What? That doesn't even make sense. Additional chat. Look, you're not going to be held responsible for what somebody says in the chat. Okay. Additional chats in the April 9th, 2021 YouTube broadcast alleged that none of the money had gone towards the custody battle and further claimed that Alamia, the lawyer, was a criminal. I mean, how are we getting to liability for what someone, not even a screen name, for what someone in a chat said? What? No. That, no. 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 That's not how that works. Cease and desist letters. Great. They're cease and desist letters. April 10th, 2021, Yates, Lloyd, Saunders were sent cease and desist letters. Why? Why? Why do you need to say cease and desist letter when they're called cease and desist letters? If you're going to refer to it as a C&D, then maybe put it in quotes. Otherwise, it's just a cease and desist and you don't need to put it in parentheses. What in the fuck? Ugh. They were sent cease and desist letters regarding their false and misleading statements. Look, if those cease and desist letters read anything like this complaint, then I'm sure that they had no fucking clue what they had said, why it was defamatory, or what even is being alleged, because I am still lost. And warning that if it continued, plaintiffs would protect themselves and their reputations to the fullest extent of the laws. What, from the dick nose comment? I would please attach the cease and desist to a future filing. I'm fascinated. April 17th, 2021, Yates went on YouTube Live with online celebrity Clegg. Is this the same Clegg from above? When defendants Yates streamed for 1 hour and 50 minutes, as of April 26th, the episode had amassed no less than 4,400 views. And? Well, on the YouTube Live, he acknowledged that he received the cease and desist. And? Are they trying to say that's how he knew that going forward? I can't even guess. I don't know. Defendant Yates pointed out to his viewers that he believed... pointed out to his viewers what he believed to be the funny part about the cease and desist letter. Please say it was the dick for a nose. Please say it was a dick for a nose comment, because that is funny. The funny part about the cease and desist letter is that he claimed to never have mentioned Jihoon's GoFundMe or the people behind it. They're saying that that's not true. Defendant Yates claimed it all came on or about April 7th. Okay. Who cares about the GoFundMe? Claimed on his YouTube Live that as far as the cease and desist, he would not mention certain people's names because of the cease and desist. But if he breached it, plaintiffs could in fact file a lawsuit against him. Well, here we are. Yates, but for what? We still don't know what they're suing for, because it is so not clear. Yates also stated on YouTube Live that he understood how cease and desist worked, that they were written by a lawyer, and that he worked for attorneys since 2017. Okay. Sure. On April 17th, 2021... Defendant Yates indicated that he wanted plaintiffs to pursue him because he understood that a lawyer must write a cease and desist. Then if Yates broke the cease and desist, or ignored it, that people must give the attorney thousands of dollars to come after him in court. I mean, that's a rough recitation of how that works. But I think he's threatening the lawyers. Don't rile the lawyers. Yates stated that if plaintiffs wanted to come after him in court and file a lawsuit against him, then they should go ahead and do it. Yep. Yep. Riling the lawyers. Rile them up. Go ahead and sue me. You're never going to sue me. Where have we heard that before? Yates went on to state that if he were breaking the cease and desist, the plaintiffs could sue him. Well, people can sue anyone for anything. Cease and desist are a conversation starter. Sometimes you should acquiesce to that conversation. Sometimes the question is, what the fuck is this even about? Defendant Yates then claimed that $30,000 was raised for a custody case that was never filed and the money was misappropriated. Oh, wait, are we getting back to other facts? I'm confused. Although there was a slander suit filed by Jihoon against Devin, none of the money raised from the GoFundMe was utilized for the slander suit. Who cares? So there was a slander suit. So there's other lawsuits. Why is everyone suing everyone? I'm so confused. Defendant Yates again state that if he broke the cease and desist letter tonight, that he wanted plaintiffs to sue him. All right, well, they did. Yay. Somebody got what they wanted. None of the rest of us got what we wanted, because this is horrible to understand. A guest named Alicia on Yates's YouTube broadcast stated, who cares what Alicia said? Stated that another online personality had a current restraining order against Yates. How is that relevant? Which supports the claim that Yates has a history of salacious, false, and misleading statements against people, and has continued. What does Alicia saying that they believed there was a restraining order have to do with any of this? They're trying to say it's malicious, but the malicious is not a. The malicious isn't about the other thing. The malicious is about these statements. This is not what's happening. Oh, and then there's, in fact, both the custody and slander matters were filed in Utah. Great. So now there's actual other cases. I don't know how they're relevant other than maybe to relate to the GoFundMe. What? professional complaints against Amalia and Drexler. This is so hard to read that we are going to skip to what the causes of actions are, because it's been 2 hours and 20 minutes of this live stream, and then we will get back into it if we need to. They're saying that plaintiff Alamia is a lawyer and that this is a law firm and that they got negative reviews from people who didn't work with him, and that Yates told his followers to file reviews and complaints with the state bar. As a general rule, if you are not the client, filing state bar complaints isn't going to get you anywhere. And riling your followers, though it might not be defamatory, is always ill-advised. And false reporting things is also ill-advised. On or about April 21st, 2021, Alamia received two bar complaints from persons not their clients. Okay. Drexler received complaints on their license in Florida, Department of Agricultural and Consumer Affairs, about his professional license. Okay. I don't know who Crosby is. Now we've got more people. I can't even follow where they're going with this, but apparently there's another live stream with everyone together with 3,652 views on YouTube talking about Charrington posting nude photos of Devin, stalking Devin and running a hate page against Devin. So now we're back to Charrington, but we talked about them up above, so I don't understand. Saying that some people are all fucking crooks, but put that up above with the other thing, it doesn't make any sense. Lloyd claimed that she knows how attorneys work. She was a paralegal court reporter, and if my attorney was on the phone with a client for 5 minutes, as soon as he hung up, he would bill them for an hour. Anyone who works in the legal field knows that's how attorneys work. I mean, that's not exactly how billing works, but okay, which is defamatory and an attack on the professional law license and their practice of law. I mean, context matters, and this is talking about another lawyer. Like, hey, in my experience, this person did this. On the same YouTube live, Lloyd further alleged that Alamia's billing, I don't know how the billing even came up or how it's known, is total disbarment right there. Okay, but what? Defendant Lloyd further recommended that Ji-hoon or anyone associated with the case should file a state bar complaint with the Utah State Bar Association, which happened on April 23rd. Okay, we're back to Kenton and you. Additional information. Why wasn't this up above? I don't know. This all should have been up above. There was another Instagram Live where somebody said, yes, that's true. Oh, now we're to the causes of action. Oh, thank Jesus. Okay, causes of action, causes of action. Defamation and defamation per se. No, no, no. Those things are different. Those things, they have different elements and they have different standards of proof. They're not the same thing, one or the other. The first cause of action can't be both. And against who and by who? Which plaintiff, which defendant, who for who? No. No. Second cause of action, false light. False light what? False light invasion of privacy? Great. But from which defendant and which plaintiff? Is it just all? All right. Invasion of privacy, intrusion upon seclusion. All? Again, all? Because this doesn't talk about the doxing at all, which I would think you would put under the invasion of privacy. It doesn't talk about the publishing of photos. It doesn't talk about the full name. It talks about allegations that aren't talked about up above. None of this is talked about up above. And we don't know who it's talking about. A claim that someone is dishonest and unethical is considered to be highly offensive. Okay, well, who said what about who? Fourth cause of action for punitive damages, I can't even. Fifth cause of action, slander, libel, and slander, libel per se. Okay, but defendants implicated plaintiffs, which in multiple felony crimes under Utah code, Okay, but which? Conversion, misappropriation of likeness, and right to publicity. What? What? Who converted what? How? Where? We know conversion is an act of willful interference with property. Okay, but where? Defendants have continued to profit from plaintiff's image and likeness to obtain monies from online sources. Who? Who? And what? I know. Seventh cause of action, intentional tortious interference with prospective economical. Well, is it intentional or is it tortious? Why is there a slash? Does Utah have two statutes? And also which defendants and which plaintiffs? I'm going to keep saying it, but which prospective economic relationships? Because most of this doesn't say that. Civil conspiracy. All the defendants work together for the object purpose of injuring and harming the plaintiffs. All plaintiffs? Because only some of the things go together. Civil harassment. Okay. Defendants intended to portray plaintiffs in a negative light falsely. But which ones? Which statements? I hate this complaint so much. 10th cause of action, preliminary and permanent injunction. Okay, you want them to stop talking about who? Prayer for relief. Oh, thank God. Monetary judgment be awarded in favor of plaintiffs against defendants for interest from the date of filing, for punitive damages, for costs, for attorney's fees, for a jury trial. No, sir. Look, my guy. This complaint is impossible to parse. I don't know how it, I've out of focused myself in my ranting. I don't know how you parse this. I think we have a jurisdiction issue and a misjoinder issue before we even get to the rambling story of like, but then he was like, and then she was like, and then they went on YouTube and there's no link and it's a video this date. And then they said, this is out of control. If the individual plaintiffs want to sue the individual defendants, look, yep, that can happen. Go ahead. But a lot of this, there's just no there. And it feels like they're trying to bootstrap claims that don't have any teeth to claims that might. The defrauding the government stuff might need a factual sorting out, but that has nothing to do with any of the rest of the stuff. So all of this together is just an absolute mess. This is improperly joined, in my opinion. There is no class action here. You've just got a whole bunch of people trying to lump a lawsuit together to try to make something work and kind of bootstrap the stronger claims with the weaker claims. It's just a mess. It needs to just start over. Just start over. And these should be separate. If the person whose business was talked about with the false PPP loan wants to sue those defendants together for having a conversation, at least the factual part of that makes sense. It's like they were talking together. They were saying the same things. That's one plaintiff versus the group of defendants. But all the other stuff is just bootstrapped together. It makes no sense. And I hate it so much. So I will keep a loose eye on what happens with this next. It's just a steaming cluster. And we've talked forever. So I'm going to look at the super chats real quick. And then we've been on for almost 2 hours and 30 minutes. Just as a reminder, none of this is legal advice. These are my thoughts and opinion on a poorly written complaint. It doesn't mean that a complaint can't be fixed. I don't know how this one gets fixed without parsing this out into separate causes of action. This thing is just a mess, but yikes. Don't forget to like and subscribe. I'm going to take a look at the super chats real quick, and then we are going to have to bounce. We will get to more questions during our members only live stream on Thursday, because we did not have time for a lot of questions today because so much happened and I tried to get to too much of it. And the mods are like, yeah, you did way too much of it, one thing at a time, but I can't just go live all week. So it all happened today. So I am going to try to get to the the super chats real quick and just say a quick thank you. And then we are going to bounce because almost 2 hours and 30 minutes. So let me pull this up on the back end so I can see them. And I'm going to go back. Jamie said that Devon and Jihoon are married and are on 90 Day Fiancé. Thank you. Lover of Life said Cardi B and Tasha K set to go to trial in September. The judge is suggesting a settlement. What's your opinion on this lawsuit and the outcome? I have not gotten into it deeply, but we will as it's getting ready for trial. There's a lot of legal stuff that has happened in that. John Yates, I see you in the chat. Not legal advice. Also, talk to your attorneys before making comments on the internet about all of this, because being involved in litigation, you know how we feel about making comments about being involved in litigation. No matter how terrible the complaint is, it can still be time consuming and difficult, and defenses need to be evaluated with an attorney that represents you. Buff Bus Bad, thank you for the super chat. Carla, thank you for the super chat. Perry Sanders, hello. Thank you for the super chat. Sierra Marie, so they are offending Utah as a state. I don't think they're offending Utah as a state. I just don't know why they picked that as a place to file this lawsuit when a lot of the causes of actions did not happen there. And I think that they're going to have a huge issue with jurisdiction. Ashley Vincent, thank you for the catnip tip for the paw nerds. Happy Pride to you as well. Buff Bus Bad said, your videos over the past year have reignited my desire / interest in studying law after undergrad. Just wanted to say thank you. You are welcome. Thank you for that very kind super chat. Lori Smith, so good to see you, who said hello to me and the wonderful Lonards. Good to see you. Hello. Timothy O'Malley, would you ever be able to be persuaded under wrongful termination, as this seems to be the motivation? Would this ever be able to be pursued? Sorry, under wrongful termination. I'm assuming that's about the NSYNC thing. No, that's more of a contractor relationship because it's an influencer being hired for marketing. So under the NSYNC stuff, no, but I will talk about that when we get into the Dave Ramsey termination lawsuit because it has to do with both. I will yeet you said personal political preferences have no place in the workplace, period. I mean, I hear you. We're going to get into that too in the Dave Ramsey case with his righteous living policy and what businesses are allowed to do and not allowed to do and where the boundaries of businesses being allowed to have their own values and core structure and identity versus discrimination that's illegal under federal law. So there's that. Just me. Thank you for the super chat. Jessica said, I've watched Bond Corp for almost 3 years. This makes me extremely happy. I'll become a member. Need more Emily. Love you on H3. Thank you. And I think that's caught up on the super chat. Thank you, everybody. What a long, long stream after being gone on Friday. I'm seeing birthday wishes to Amy. Happy birthday. Happy birthday, Amy. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Thank you all. Amy, yay. Happy, happy birthday, Amy. It's good to see you in the chat as always, and we appreciate you. You guys, I know today was a wandering ride, and I'm sorry that we didn't get to many questions. Thank you. Thank you, Amy. You made my day with this trashy hysterical lawsuit. Thanks to you and the mods. Yes, a huge thanks to the mods. I know that when we talk about creators that are polarizing, like KJ and Amanda Ensing, that the chat can get polarized. I know that when we talk about things that have political and ideological parts to them, it can also get polarizing. And I know that we get people that come into the videos that aren't part of the Law Nerds community, that aren't always familiar with how we do things, and that can be tough. Thank you to the mods for writing for 2.5 hours and for dealing with it. And then we got to all of the ridiculousness that is this YouTuber lawsuit. But what I will say is I think that we are at the beginning of YouTuber litigation. I don't think we're going to see the end of this. I do not love lawsuits that don't make sense. I do not love trying to put the kitchen sink into a thing. The NSYNC suit at least was well written. I mean, it's clear what the NSYNC suit is. So There's that takeaway. We will get to questions in our members only live stream on Thursday and get to chat a little bit more. I'm sorry we got so far and away with this one today. Thank you for hanging. Hopefully the supersized makes up for the lack of a live stream on Friday. I will be live tomorrow on vidIQ's channel. I will share that in the text crew and I will share that out here. There will be a new podcast episode Wednesday that will be audio only because I am behind. There will be a new audio and video episode next Wednesday. What else is coming up? Members only live stream on Thursday and then back for Friday Night Live on Friday. Y'all, this is just crazy. Crazy. Thank you for being here. I know we've wrapped up like 17 times. I appreciate you. I will see you in the next one. I will be in the comment section to try to answer some questions down below. So go ahead and leave them. And I will see you on Thursday and or Friday and or tomorrow on vidIQ's channel. Bye, everybody. Connect with me everywhere. I'm at the Emily D. Baker. If you guys want to join the text, just text emily.com. If you want to join the channel, lawnerdsunite.com. Happy to have you support what we do here on the YouTube channel.